أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا مولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا مولانا محمد عبده ورسوله قال تعالى الذي خلق فسوى والذي قدر فهدى والذي أخرج المرعى فجعله غثاء أحوى صدق الله العظيم. عن العلماء جماعة المسلمين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. My topic is basically environment and humanity. Now I will firstly go back into the ayat in the hadith of Nabi Muhammad SAW concerning the environment, and then I'll come to the humanity issue. Allah Ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, Alladhi khalaqa fasawwa. Allah is the one who has created and then proportioned it. In other words, the tafsir explains that Allah Ta'ala created everything in the best of forms. Whatever Allah Ta'ala created was in the best of forms. Allah says further, وَالَّذِي قَدَّرَ فَهَدَى. And Allah is the one who is measured and guided. In other words, the tafsir explains once again that Allah Ta'ala determined beforehand the function of everything. Now many a times we as humanity will live on this earth, and sometimes we see certain insects, certain plants, it doesn't have a function in this dunya. For example, many times we find that the ants in the house eating our food should be killed, and we just do it. Sometimes we find certain trees in our way, and we just destroy it. But Allah is the creator of all those things. The ants, the trees, the plants, whatever Allah Ta'ala created, there's a purpose for that. And everyone will find that the environment is being destroyed today. Because humanity thinks, they think that all the things and many of the things Allah Ta'ala created doesn't have a function in this dunya. In Jama'atul Muslimin, one will find that the creation of Allah Ta'ala, Allah speaks about Allah's creation. In the Quran, Allah says, for example, الذي خلق سبع سماوات طباقا ما ترى في خلق الرحمن من تفاوت فارجع البصر هل ترى من فطور. Allah Ta'ala says in Surah Al-Mulk, Allah says, Allah is the one who created the seven heavens one above the other. Allah says further, ما ترى في خلق الرحمن من تفاوت. Allah says, you can see no fault in the creation of the most gracious. Allah makes this statement. Allah says, you can see no fault in the creation of the most gracious. Now Allah says, Farji il basar. Then look at the creation. And Allah follows up with the question, Hal tara min futur. Can you see any rifts? Can you see anything wrong with the creation of Allah Ta'ala? Now Allah goes further. Allah says, ثُمَّرْجِ الْبَصَرَ كَرَّتَيْنِ يَنْقَلِبِ إِلَيْكَ الْبَصَرُ خَاسِ وَهُوَ خَسِيرٌ. Allah says, then look again. And look another time again to the creation of Allah Ta'ala. Your sight will become khosia. Your sight will become exhausted. Because you can see nothing wrong in the great creation of Allah Ta'ala. Now Jama'atul Muslimin, today we live in this dunya. Now Allah Ta'ala created the plants with us and the animal kingdom. And Jama'atul Muslimin, one thing we must realize, that all those creations of Allah Ta'ala has got certain functions. Now when one studies the subject of ilmul kalam, what they call tawheed, then what the ulama will do in ilmul kalam, one will see when you study that subject, that we know as Muslims We cannot see Allah Ta'ala. We believe what they call is the ghaib, in the unseen. But the ulama of the ilm al-kalam will use the signs of this dunya, and we will use various verses of the Quran to show you the greatness of Allah Ta'ala's existence. Now, Jama'atun, Allah says, Inna fis samawati wal ardi la ayatin lil mu'minin. Allah says, verily in the heavens and the earth are signs for the believers. And they you will find if we study Tawheed, they will use certain things. And I'm not going to go in that section now. But they will use to understand the greatness of Allah Ta'ala. They will use that. Now the question is, if we destroy the dunya as we are doing today, how in the next few generations one will find that where will the trees be? Where will the plants be? The animal kingdom will see them in the museums. And they are the creation of Allah Ta'ala. In Jama'at al-Muslimin, Nabi Muhammad Sallam said in the hadith, قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمْ لَا ضَرَرَ وَلَا ضِرَارَ. There should be no more harming, no inflicting harm. And we should not harm Jama'at al-Muslimin, the dunya. Allah says in the Quran, وَلَا تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ بَعْدَ إِسْلَاحِهَا. Allah Ta'ala says, do not do mischief on the earth after Allah Ta'ala set it in order. Allah created this dunya, but we must not destroy it. Today one will find that we destroy the trees, for example. There's something which you call deforestation. Deforestation is where they cut down the trees at a very, very enormous rate. A very great rate, they cut down the trees. In Jama'at al-Muslimin, one will find that the tree plays a very, very important role. The tree, for example, during the process of photosynthesis, the tree takes in the carbon dioxide and gives oxygen to us. One will find that certain areas, the tree gives rain to the areas. Now, how does it happen? You know, the tree gives water to the atmosphere. Right, they call it transpiration. Right, like in the inland areas, you know, for example, here in Cape Town, a good example, the cold front comes over the Atlantic Ocean and it picks up the fog and brings rain to Cape Town. Alhamdulillah, we are lucky, we're near to the coast. But in the inland areas, there's no ocean near to that. So they depend on the trees to give water to the atmosphere. And from that form clouds. And from there comes rain. Now, Jama'at al-Muslimin, if one cuts down all those trees without replanting and we don't replant again as we are cutting down, what will happen? There will be a reduction in the growth of the earth, of the plants, and of the trees. Now, Jama'at al-Muslimin, the process of deforestation takes place in many of the equatorial regions of the earth. It's around the equator and the tropical regions. Now, those regions are known as the lungs of the earth. It gives, you know, the oxygen to the rest of the earth. Because, for example, in the desert areas, there's no trees growing, but people are living there. So the atmosphere circulates the oxygen, and they get the oxygen from the trees in the tropical equatorial regions. In Jama'at al-Muslimin, there's been many appeals not to cut down the trees at this rate. Now, Jama'at al-Muslimin, one will find, you've heard of global warming, I'll come later back to that. If we cut down the trees at this rate that we are doing now, you know the trees reduces the carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, right? But if the trees have been cut down, what will happen? We'll be dying soon because there are plus amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. So Jama'at al-Muslimin, look at the great words of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said in the hadith, Man qada sidratan, sawaballahu ra'asahu fi nar. He says in the hadith, whoever cuts down a low tree without justification, Allah will send him to hellfire. The hadith in Abu Dawud. This is a great teaching of Nabi Muhammad SAW. And he, Nabi Muhammad SAW, he knew exactly why a tree is important. Now the low tree referred to here is a tree that grows in the desert. But the tree today, man can take it today, in general, all the trees are very important. Jamaatul Muslimin, we as Muslims, we don't realize how important agriculture is for us. You know, I want to just go back into history. One will find that the Muslim people, they were the great agriculturalists of the world at a certain time in the history of us, from the time of Nabi Muhammad SAW. One will find, for example, that when Nabi Muhammad SAW came in Medina, he found an agricultural society, an agrarian society. The Ansar were people known for the agriculture. They were great agriculturists. As Islam spread to other parts of the world, all right, from Medina to Mecca to other places, they took that agricultural knowledge with them. So much so, Jamaatul Muslimin, that when Islam ruled, and there was a time when Islam ruled, from Spain, Portugal, right to China, and Islam ruled from the central part of Russia, right until the borders of South Africa, even Mozambique, that was the Islamic Empire. And one of the readings which I found was that Muslims were very much close to the agriculture. And when they went for Hajj every year, what did they do? They took the seed into their pockets, right? And when they came to the Holy Kaaba in Mecca, they exchanged the seed with one another. People from Spain, from Portugal, from Russia, from Southeast Asia, they used to exchange the seeds amongst one another. And so much so, the agriculture in the Muslim world became a great product for us. For example, Jamaatul Muslimin, we know oranges, right? Now, orange in Arabic is known as burtukal. Now, when Islam ruled Spain, they were very much dominant in agriculture there. Now, Portugal comes from the word burtukal. And burtukal means orange. That was known as the land of the oranges. It just shows that before the Europeans, when they retook over the Iberian Peninsula, you know, that was a Muslim country. Spain and Portugal was a Muslim, Iberian Peninsula was a Muslim country before. Before they, in fact, they came to learn from the Muslims about agriculture. They traveled far and wide the world to go after the knowledge of the Muslim agriculturists. It's sad today, Jamaatul Muslimin, that Muslim countries are importing agriculture. Whether they were the people who were the dominant people. You know, in Sahih al-Bukhari, there's a whole bab, a whole chapter on agriculture. And Nabi Muhammad SAW, he used to encourage the planting of trees, right? In one hadith he says, there's none amongst the Muslims who plants a tree or sow seeds, and then a bird or a person, an animal eats from it, but is regarded as a charitable gift for him. A hadith in Imam Bukhari. That Nabi Muhammad SAW, he used to encourage the planting of trees. So if you plant a tree and a bird come, or an animal come, or an insect come, and they eat from that, you will still benefit from that. You know, nowadays you've got this Arbor Day, right? I think it's coming here September. That was taught to us 1400 years ago by Nabi Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So why can't we be the people who are in the forefront of planting trees? Today one will find, and I must stress this, that in South Africa, we've got a great unemployment rate. Unemployment is very, very aggressive. You know, the people are really suffering in this country due to various factors. But what keeps up and stops us from planting those who don't have work? Allah's given you rain. Allah's given you soil. And Allah's giving you sunshine. Three things you need for planting. The rest is your effort. I don't know why people sometimes, they stand on the corner the whole day and wait for a job. And this afternoon, they go home, no one picked them up. They go hungry home. The family are suffering. Whether they can follow the sunnah of Nabi Muhammad, to plant, even the Muslim people. You know, when you got those three things, then you will see you can never go hungry. And the moment you start planting, the seeds grow. And from there you start to accumulate and you start moving forward and forward into your agricultural job, whatever you want to do. But it is important that your agriculture becomes a very strong thing in the Muslim community. Jamaatul Muslimin, one must also remember that if we destroy the trees in such a rate, the insects and all those animals are suffering. You know, there are so many things, for example, just as the other day I got an email that we are, nowadays, the farmers are spreading pesticides onto the farms, you know, on the agriculture. But what happens is, the bees come, and look, the bees got a very important role to play. They pollinate the plants. But they can't pollinate the plants because there's poison on the plants. And so what happens is, the whole cycle, the ecology cycle, is being affected because the bees can't pollinate the plants because of the poison on that. A small thing which we think we are now protecting the plants. You know, many years ago, when people planted, there were no pesticides. They didn't use all this kind of poison. But today, we use all these kind of things, and people are ill. Many times, one will find that people are suffering today of cancer. Many people are dying of cancer today. And they go back and you see where the origin of the cancer. It comes from these kind of things, Jamaatul Muslimin. Be that as it may, Jamaatul Muslimin, Allah Ta'ala also created the animal kingdom. And the animal kingdom plays a very, very important role for us. You know, in one verse Allah says, وَمَا مِنْ دَابَةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا طَائِرِ يَطِيرُ بِجَنَاحَيْ إِلَّا أُمَمٌ أَمْثَالُكُمْ. Allah says, there is not an animal that lives on earth, nor a being that flies on its wings, but form part of communities like you. Jamaatul Muslimin, the animal kingdom, they form part of us. Whether it is a minute insect, whether it's the biggest animal, Jamaatul Muslimin, they play a part in this dunya. What we are doing today on this dunya, we are killing them like anything. Number one, we are destroying the habitat, the place where they must stay. We're destroying the wetlands. We're destroying the trees. You know, many a times, I just see the other day now, I was driving here through one of the roads, and one sees how the council fill up the wetlands with sand. You know the wetlands? It plays a very important role, Jamaatul Muslimin. They're going to build there. And Jamaatul Muslimin, you know the wetlands, plays a very, very vital role for the ecology of Cape Town. The wetlands plays a very important role. If you go up here, that is Wildevreden Road, it's a big wetland here. Right? But many of the wetlands, you look at the N2, you go down the N2, right along the N2, there's a wetlands, right down. Which means the N2, both sides of the N2, you find wetlands. Which means the N2 stands in the wetlands. But when you destroy the wetlands, we kill so many birds where they must stay, where they must breed. right? In fact, the wetlands, they absorb the water during the water in the winter. And during the summer, they release the water for the rivers. And Jamaatul Muslimin, the animal kingdom, we destroy the habitat. We don't only kill the habitat, but we kill themselves. You know, the rhinos, for example. How are the rhinos not being destroyed in Africa? For a reason that the Chinese only know. Because the Chinese people believe that the horn of the rhino is something vital for their medicine. And it was proven to them it doesn't work. But they killed the rhino at a very, very great rate. So Jamaatul Muslimin, what happens is that we kill the animal kingdom at a very great rate. Jamaatul Muslimin, what I also want to say is that Nabi Muhammad Sallam says in the hadith, he says, he forbade the killing of four animals, the ants, the hoopoe birds, and the shrikes, and the bees. Right? Four animals he prohibited us to kill. Now, how much do we kill the ants these days? You know, we take our doom, and we just spread it down here. We kill the ants. The bees plays a very important role. The shrikes, it's just a certain bird. I looked on the internet last night. It's a very beautiful bird. But we're not allowed to kill them. And also the hoopoe bird. We're not allowed to kill them. We're going to hadith Nabi Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In Jamaatul Muslimin, what happens now if we kill the animal kingdom? Sometimes we disturb the ecology cycle. For example, if we in the Indian Ocean must kill the sharks, what will happen? The seals will increase. All right? If the seals increase, what will happen? There will be no fish in the sea. And this Jamaatul Muslimin, in every area we will find, we always kill those animals on top of the range. Right? Now the other day it was in the newspaper. Right? That if we kill certain birds, those birds that cause the catches of prey down below, what will happen is, then certain illness will spread in the community. Because the birds, they kill the rats, they kill the mice, for certain purposes. In Jamaatul Muslimin, we'll find that everywhere we disturb the ecology cycle. You know, one day there's a very beautiful argument. One day there was, in Australia, the people killed all the snakes in the area. And what did they find? They found that the mice and the rats increased. And those mice and rats, they ate the corn. And people started to starve. What did they have to do? They had to import snakes from another area to neutralize the situation. And so much so, Jamaatul Muslimin, nowadays, we kill all those animals on top of the range. And it is vital that we do not do that. You know, it is so beautiful, this Deen of Islam, that it teaches us not to kill the animals without any justification. Because, Jamaatul Muslimin, if one kills an animal, all right, without justification, in the hadith of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it is said, if you kill a sparrow senselessly, it will hasten to Allah on the day of judgment saying, our Rabb so-and-so killed me for play and not for use. A hadith in Imam Nasa'i. If you kill a sparrow senselessly, day of Qiyamah, without any use, you will appear in front of Allah Ta'ala and Allah will make judgment between you and that bird. There's one example given by Nabi Muhammad. You know how much do we kill our animals? If we look today, and this is one great worry which scientists tell you. You know the fish in the sea? They are being drawn up by the trawlers and by the gill nets. is one great problem in the world today. That what happens is that they go into the sea and they pull up the fish, just like this, all right? And they want, they want certain fish that they want from there. But the fish that they don't want also come into the nets. And what happens is, Jamaat al-Muslimin, those fish that they do not want, it's already dead by the time it comes by the boat. And they throw it back into the sea. And so much so, what they're saying is, they are emptying the oceans these days. What will happen in 20, 30 years time down the line? We won't have any fish in the sea. Right? They go to the deepest, in fact, they've got satellite knowledge now on where the best fish are lying. Right? They look at from the satellite up there. And they go into those fishing grounds where the big fish are lying, the best fish. And they go with the net into there and take it from there. And some of the fish, they take very long to grow to maturity. I mean, they can start breeding. They're killing the small fish, their children, put it that way, and they're killing the elderly ones. So in other words, they're killing the whole cycle of the fish in the sea, not realizing how important it is for us. And Jamaat al-Muslimin, once you kill and you disturb the cycle, you're going to have problems. I want to come to what is known now as global warming. I think I must stress that global warming is a very, very important thing for us. One will find that today that everyone is using carbon dioxide. Whether you like it or not, you're driving a car. You're putting carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. And what happens is, during this process of putting carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, as I explained earlier, we're killing the trees. There's no tree that can reduce the carbon dioxide. All the CO2 goes up into the atmosphere. Now there's a certain time of the day. You know, during the daytime, the sun warms the earth, right? The surface of the earth. What happens is at night, the earth radiates those heat back to the atmosphere. But what happens is the carbon dioxide, it is in the atmosphere and it blocks the radiation going into the atmosphere. And what happens is those heat comes back to the earth. And that's what they call global warming. They call it the greenhouse effect. Right? I'll just explain it again. What happens is basically during the day the sun heats the earth, the surface of the earth. During the night, the earth radiates. Those heat go back to the atmosphere. But those heat can't go because all the carbon dioxide which we put into the atmosphere, it is up there, right? It blocks the heat going out. So heat comes back to the earth. And this, therefore, we're sitting what they call global warming. And global warming, Jamaat al-Muslimin, it is affecting everywhere the weather patterns in the world. You know, look at Cape Town now. We haven't had the rain that we usually have every year because of global warming. Scientists said, for example, we will have rain, but we'll have rain, a lot of rain in a very short time. You know, in Cape Town it used to be for over 2 weeks it used to rain. I couldn't even remember. Over 2 weeks sometime, you know, there's 14 days of continuous rain. But now it doesn't happen anymore because of global warming. And it happens everywhere, the same problem is existing. Now this global warming, Jamaat al-Muslimin, those countries who put the most carbon dioxide into the atmosphere do not want to come in agreement that they are going to stop producing carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. And the biggest culprits here is the United States and the Chinese. They're putting an enormous amount of CO2 into the atmosphere. And no one can do anything to them. It's very sad, Jamaat al-Muslimin. They say they're going to come to agreement because both of them are fighting for the dominance of the economy in the world. Because if United States say if they're going to reduce their carbon dioxide, They can't produce so many things. But there are other things which they can use. There's, for example, what we know as green technology. You know, they can produce electricity by using green technology. And green technology is, we use the sun, right, to produce energy for you. South Africa is a good example how we can produce green technology. You know the Northern Cape, that is now that part, Kimberley, that area up there. They got most of the year, it is a sunshine area, right? So when they produce green technology, they can use that sun in those areas to produce energy for South Africa, right? Port Elizabeth and Cape Town are very windy areas at time. They can use the wind to produce energy. You've got so much waves that we can use for energy. But people still want to. Here's South Africa recently went now to ask the Russians and have an agreement with the Russians to produce nuclear energy. We're going worse, Damatrums. We are going worse. Because nuclear energy, once you go that route, the biggest problem with nuclear energy is what do you do with the waste? Nuclear waste. You know? Where do you bury nuclear waste? There's no way you can bury it when it's safe because you can't put it into space. But people still want to go for the shortest route. Eventually, the world will realize that they must go to green technology. Jamaatul Muslimin, what is very vital is that there are so many examples that global warming is affecting this dunya. For example, one will find that the glaciers on the polar regions are melting. If those glaciers are melting, what will happen? The water in the oceans will increase. And what will then happen is the coastal regions will be affected. You know, there was one day I was in Durban at a conference. So this brother, unfortunately I was the chair of that meeting and I couldn't get the brother's name. But he said he comes from Tanzania, as you say it, somewhere in Dar es Salaam. And I see on the coast, they used to play in a certain area near to the beach when he was a kid, about 30 years ago. But he says that area today, he stays there. You can't play there anymore. Because the whole area is filled up with water on a daily basis, which means that the water on the oceans are increasing. And what will happen as the water increases, right? The ice caps are melting on the polar regions. What will happen to this world? And the global warming is affecting everything, right? There was a time when we told him that, listen, that the threshold which the atmosphere can take of carbon dioxide is 350 ppm. Right? They went past 350, it's now over 400. It's over 400 ppm. Right? So many times we're telling countries to reduce your carbon dioxide output. Get away from nuclear energy. Go back to green technology. And one will find the economy of the world, can see there's a whole slum in the economy of the world. Why is it so? Why is it so? Because global warming is playing a role everywhere. And one will find, if we are not going to stand up and say, no, this is enough, we are in for a catastrophe. You know, there's something called sustainable development. There's a conference coming up now in Malaysia on how Islam will view sustainable development. Now, this, we know that the ulama of fiqh will tell you there's something called in the fiqh what they call maqasid al-sharia. Maqasid al-sharia, right? The objectives of the sharia, right? And the five objectives which must be protected is the deen, life, the mind, offspring and property. But one conference when I was there in Malaysia a few years ago, I said that we must bring the environment into this. Because if we don't protect the environment, then what is the use? You want to protect property. Because property will be destroyed. What is the use? You want to protect offspring. Because that will be destroyed. Right? What is the use? You want to protect life. Because that will be destroyed. And therefore the environment protection is very, very important. I've just given you a few ahadith and ayat of the Holy Quran. But one will find that the Muslims has got all the knowledge and the know-how how to protect the environment. You know, Jamaat al-Muslimin, many a times, and I must say this, we go to conferences, one will find that all the religions are there, all right? And what happens is that all the religions must present from their basis, how can we protect the environment? How can we have a solution for the protecting of the environment? And when we go to these conferences, we go with the ayat of the Quran and the sunnah and the hadith of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we can always see there's a lot of solutions in the Quran and the hadith of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The other religions don't have it from the basics. Really, really, I can tell you that. All right? And we've got a lot that we can offer for this world. We've got a lot how we can offer for this world. And therefore I say that I said to the MGC also, I need ulama who can assist me in protecting the environment. I need ulama to make research in this field and show the world how we can protect the environment. You know, nowadays I find, when I go into the internet, one will find that because of my research in this, one will find that many of the other religions, they write things about the protecting of the environment. They use the ayat of the Quran and the hadith of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But they don't say it comes from the Quran, and they don't say it comes from Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Can you see what happens to Lady Jamaat al-Muslimin? Other nations are seeing what the light of the Quran is, and what is the light of the Sunnah of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is. We don't really see it, or we don't want to see it. But let our students go into this field and produce lots of work. You know, I must go back into history. The Muslims were the developers of algebra, the developers of trigonometry, the developers of calculus. You know, today, when they started to sleep, other nations took it over and they developed it further. The same is going to happen if we're not going to wake up Jamaat al-Muslimin. Here we've got the Quran and we've got the Ahadith of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why did mathematics develop so much? You know one reason why? When it came to earth, you know, inheritance. As a Muslim population grew, things became a bit difficult to calculate, right? We call in the fiqh the awl and the rad. They call that in the fiqh, right? Where they have to calculate certain difficult calculations in the inheritance. And they had to develop mathematical formulas to be able to give answers for the calculation of the inheritance. Another example, people stayed in Spain. They had to get their route to Mecca for Hajj. From Russia, they get the route. And they developed the maps and the routes and everything. They developed that. How to get to the holy city of Mecca? They had to face the Qibla. And they developed a way how to face the Qibla. Therefore, the geography advanced. Right? And Jamaat al-Muslimin, they were the great people in medicine. They were the great people in many, many fields in science. But they went to sleep. Because it was all inspired from the Quran and the Hadith of Nabi Muhammad. Today we've got the environment story. Once again we're sitting here. There is a Quran and the Hadith of Nabi Muhammad. Let us develop that as a nation. My appeal is, you can go to the website, right? Type in Muhammad Ridwan Khalan. Type in the Kanala, please. In Google. You'll find a lot of work that Alhamdulillah try to produce. May Allah Ta'ala make me strong, inshallah. I don't want to say, but because there's two people who's doing this in the world. It's myself and Abu Sway from Palestine. Okay? In fact, that person, Abu Sway, he was a person who I got a lot of information from. Very helpful person. And also Fazlul Khalid from London is also working on that. But Jamaat al-Muslimin, if you go to the MDC website, I've put some stuff on there. But it's just only for reading purposes. I want our children to go into there and see the light of the great teaching of the Quran and the great teaching of Nabi Muhammad. You know, Jamaat al-Muslimin, I just want to say one thing, not an environment. Why do we make our iftar with a date in water? Why was it recommended by Nabi Muhammad Sallam to eat a date or water? Look at the brilliant teaching of Nabi Muhammad Sallam. You know why? Because the stomach is empty. And date is natural. And water is natural. So the stomach will identify. When it comes in there, will take it up much easier than any other thing that you take. And look at the great teaching of Nabi Muhammad Sallam. Something natural will help you. A date is natural. Water is natural. So look, Nabi Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he taught us many things. But we must look at the analysis of what he said. You know, one day I was talking to one of the ulama of Cape Town, and I said to him, you know, this is one of the great ulama of Cape Town, he said to me, you know, I look at the sharh of the ahadith, the Fathul Bari, the Sar Imam of Sahih Muslim by Imam Nawawi, the Sar of Abu Dawud. And one looks at these kind of works, and you look at the Sar, and it comes to this ahadith of nature. And I said to him, you know what? Today we are so advanced. We are in the space age. But how come these people knew so much about nature? The thing that they explained to us in the Sar, is so near to the people what we're finding today. He said to me, you know what? Those people live near to nature. It just shows how brilliant our scholars were in the past. Imam Asqalani, who wrote Fathul Bari, Imam Nawawi, who wrote the Sar of Sahih Muslim. Many of the people in the past, they wrote brilliantly. But there's a gap that existed from there until now. But coming back to the environment, we've got a lot of answers for this dunya, inshallah. Whether it is global warming, whether it is using all our things in this dunya, like planting. Planting, it is very vital, right? We can teach people the value of the sunnah of Nabi Muhammad SAW. Go back to Medina. Go back to that era of Nabi Muhammad SAW in Medina. Then we will see how great the value of planting was. Inshallah, Jamaat, may Allah grow us in strength and be strength, inshallah. Allah grant us, give us the tawfiq and the hidayah, that we may be the example for this world. Whether it is male or female, each and every one of us are here to play a part. We can once again, if we want to attract the non-Muslims to this deen of Islam, we must attract them with something. Give them examples of the value of the Quran. Give them examples of the value of the Hadith of Nabi Muhammad SAW. Inshallah will become once again that strong nation which we were before, inshallah. Walhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen.